In a 1924 article published in the Cambridge Philosophical Society, the authors write, "The only really useful practical method for solving numerical algebraic equations of higher orders is that devised by C.H. Graeffe early in the 19th century. The method has been certified fresh by mathematicians everywhere, but students are less enthused. If you take some example polynomial, in this case x cubed minus 13x squared plus 32x minus 20 equal to 0, you can solve for it only using the coefficients, in this case 13, 32, and 20. Find the roots of 10, 2, and 1 with no prior knowledge of root finding. This is called Graeffe's method, attributed to him from an 1837 article. But before Graeffe published his method, Dandelin and Lobachevsky also published similar approaches in 1826 and 1834. These methods all differ slightly in their approaches, but are essentially doing the same thing. For a complete breakdown, I recommend this paper, Dandelin, Lobachevsky, or Graeffe, by Householder. Yes, that's the same Householder from Householder's method. We can write a polynomial in terms of its roots, for example, 10, 2, and 1, and then expand it using FOIL or some other method to the more generic form, in this case, x cubed minus 13x squared plus 32x minus 20. These coefficients, for example, 13, has a special relationship to those roots. In this case, 10 plus 2 plus 1 gives us 13. 32 has another relation. It is every pair of roots multiplied together and then added. The final number, 20, are all of our roots multiplied together. You could also work backwards. For example, given this polynomial of x cubed minus 105x squared plus 504x minus 400, you could try to reverse engineer what the roots that went into it are, a, b, and c. Knowing what we know about coefficients, 105 is a plus b plus c. 504, every pair multiplied together and then added. And 400, every root multiplied together. You might be able to figure out what these are. That's right, 100, 4, and 1. I'm going to use our a, b, and c notation to then rewrite our expansion, to use a special notation called bracketing. For example, x cubed plus bracket a, x squared plus bracket ab, x plus bracket abc. Here, bracket a means it's the sum of all single roots. Bracket ab means it is every pair multiplied and then summed. And bracket abc is every trio multiplied and then summed. And you keep continuing the pattern. Also note that here A has the largest magnitude absolute value, followed by B and C. This bracket notation also works when we're raising A, B, and C to the same power. Let's call this power M, and all of our notation will follow the same pattern. For example, if we took our original roots of 10, 2, and 1 and used them to the same power of 2, we could expand our function to be x cubed plus 105x squared plus 504x plus 400. And just to be clear, these were the same roots that we reverse engineered earlier of 100, 4, and 1. Note though that our signs in our polynomial don't quite match up with that earlier version, but for our intents and purposes, it's not going to matter. What if our polynomial in terms of its roots were 10 to the 64, 2 to the 64, and 1 to the 64? What would that look like when you expand it? It would be a very long polynomial, but you could figure out these coefficients using our rules from earlier. What if you wanted to start with that polynomial and go backwards to figure out its roots? We'll use our a to the m bracket notation, meaning a to the m bracket is a to the m plus b to the m plus c to the m, giving that large number. And we had this property that a's magnitude was much larger than our other two, meaning that when m is large, a to the m is much, much larger than b or c combined. And it turns out that the log of bracket am is approximately equal to the log of the absolute value of a to the m. We can extract the m on the right-hand side using properties of logs, in this case specifically that log of x to the y is exactly equal to y times log of x. Using another property of logs being that if I take a number and raise it to the log of that number, I get what was the argument of the log. Using that knowledge, I can solve for the absolute value of a. Plug in our bracket a to the m into our logs function, and we get that a is approximately the absolute value of 10. But why was it absolute value of 10 instead of just 10? Keep in mind that when raising to an even power, we actually lose whether our number was positive or negative. In this case, 64 is even, and we'll just always assume that m is an even number. Once we found a, we can then solve for b using our approximation from earlier. We can divide out am from ambm in our bracket notation. Using another property of logs, we can turn that division into subtraction to make our life easier. Then, raise to a power like we did before, and we get that the absolute value of b is 2. Finally, now that we know a and b, we can solve for c. Our same approach from earlier, we can divide out ab, bracket notation with m, from a to the m, b to the m, c to the m in brackets, giving this approximation of 1 in absolute value. Of course, this approach is kind of roundabout. It means knowing m and our large polynomial to solve for a, b, and c of some polynomial of unknown roots, even though we generated that large polynomial from known roots. Is there a way to solve or create our new polynomial from our original one? And there is. Our first step is to set our polynomial in terms of 0. We'll leave our odd-powered x terms on the left side and move our even-powered terms over to the right. Then, square both sides of our polynomial and expand them. Afterwards, we'll simplify to come up with x to the 6th minus 105x to the 4th plus 504x squared minus 400 equal to 0. Those terms should look oddly familiar. Let's let y be x squared to then rewrite our polynomial in terms of y. And finally, replace y with x and we have our polynomial from last time. This means we go from a polynomial with unknown roots a, b, and c to a new polynomial that has roots a squared, b squared, and c squared. Of course, this means m of 2, not m of 64. That means we'll have to repeat this step a few more times. From our original polynomial, we apply our root squaring to have m of 2 to come up with our second polynomial. Square that again to have m of 4, m of 8, m of 16, 32, and 64, that very long polynomial that we used to then solve for our roots. In our case, 10, 2, and 1 in absolute value. Of course, these are in absolute value, which means I have to plug those back into our original using positive and negative versions of each of those values. Of course, we let m be 64, but how do you know how many times you need to repeat this? When should you stop? You could just let m be a large value like 64 or 128, or try to solve for the roots after every iteration of our root squaring technique. And whenever a distance becomes less than some preset epsilon, stop the iteration process. Odds are you won't want to do more than a few iterations by hand, especially if a polynomial becomes this large. So you'll want to program it, but large numbers can end up overflowing, especially with integers that have 64 bits, or doubles with only 52-bit mantissa. You'll need to use either variable precision or very high precision, or apply symbolic programming, which will make our polynomials easier to solve, also easily handle large numbers, with the drawback of it being slightly slower. For further reading, I recommend checking out The Calculus of Observations by Whitaker and Robinson, which I relied on heavily for this video, as well as Notes on the Graeffe Method of Root Squaring by Best, and also the paper that I mentioned at the beginning of this video from 1924. To refresh what we've gone over, Graeffe's root squaring method only uses our coefficients and doesn't use any derivatives to find all of our roots at the same time. Of course, Dandelin and Lobachevsky should probably also get credit for the method, and you can use symbolic programming to make the math easier. You can use a large value for m, or stop when you have a small step size. With some modification, you can make this work on complex roots, and I would also recommend checking out Horner's method, Durand-Kerner, Albrecht-Ehrlich, and Bairstow's method. The symbolic program that I wrote will be hosted on GitHub. As always, thank you for watching and for your support of this channel. I will put links to all of the resources I used in the description box below the video. If you enjoyed this video or found the content useful, consider dropping a super thanks. Or just leave a comment, like, or subscribe. I always appreciate it. Again, thank you for watching.